have to understand that if your records aren't prepared, when I talk about records, I'm talking about things that you don't think about. You know, how long have you had customer agreements that haven't been updated? How long have you had employment agreements that haven't been updated? How long have you had vendor agreements that haven't been updated? I mean, there are lots of things that you have to do, whether you've got one party or you've got multiple parties that you're going to be negotiating with, that you have to have prepared if you're going to have a relatively smooth process and transaction. But dealing with one party tends to reduce the number of potential confidentiality breaches because you're dealing with just one party. If you're dealing with a party that's made multiple acquisitions and you've done your homework on that party and you know that they do what they say they're going to do, it can be a pretty smooth process. Only thing you can't know is there's no way to know what the maximum price is you can get for your business because you only have one party and one offer. But if you get what you want and you're happy with that and there's very good reasons that that transaction should go into place, that can be very acceptable.
Well, I would say that's an argument also if you have only one buyer for maybe getting some consulting on some analysis of other valuations that Jim mentioned.
One of the considerations we talked about earlier too was the synergies that the buyer might bring to the table. Well, if you're dealing with just one buyer, what are their synergies versus somebody that's three states over that's really looking to target your area that you don't even know they exist? So in order to maximize the value to your company, you want to create a situation where you can figure out what each potential buyer is going to bring to the table, and ultimately, most often it would be the case where you're going to be able to maximize that value. Now, the structure of the deal also really weighs into it heavily as well. Maybe that potential buyer that's willing to pay the highest price, maybe the whole structure that they're considering is considerably different than a different buyer. Maybe there's more of an earn-out situation. And so you have to weigh all those factors and really determine what's going to be best for you as a seller of your company, what's best for your employees if that's important to you. So those considerations all come into play.
It's sort of like comparing insurance policies, right? Yes, you had a question.
I was just wondering, you talked a lot about getting a house in order and your business valuation. What are some of the, I don't know if you can call them standard, but some of the reoccurring items that you see customers saying, well, I could do this before I sell my business and maybe that would give me a higher value. How do you help them weigh that's going to be beneficial or that's not going to be as beneficial?
I'll touch base on this real quick, and then I think maybe Dave can provide some additional info. But one thing, if you are a business owner and you're looking to sell your company maybe within a 2 or 3 year time frame, a lot of times companies will be tax motivated the way that they might recognize revenue or certain expenses. It is generally about tax avoidance and pushing those tax issues into the future. And so you might take accelerated depreciation, you might make decisions that are going to minimize your bottom line in the short term because you know that you're going to save taxes. Well, if you're looking to sell your company and you know that's going to happen over the next few years, maybe to attract buyers, the better situation is to avoid those short-term tax gains and show a more profitable bottom line so that when you are parading yourself in front of potential buyers, you have just a pristine balance sheet and income statement that shows a greater degree of profitability, because it's much easier to start with that number as opposed to starting with a small number and say, well, we need to add this and this and this and this because we made those decisions just to save on taxes. So I think it's easier when you're starting with that higher number to begin with, and maybe Dave can talk about that.
Yeah, I would say you're on target with that, Jim. A lot of people are, I don't want to say lazy, but they don't see the need to have a different set of financial statements. You hear people joke around about how many different sets of books that we have. Sure, you can do all your tax planning and try to minimize taxes, and we do that all the time. But you might, if you're thinking about selling, or if you want to always be ready to sell, you probably want to have some financial statements that are prepared on a GAAP basis, which is generally accepted accounting principles. We have clients, the bank doesn't require an audit, nobody requires an audit, but they have audited financial statements every year, just so that they're ready and so that they're presenting them on a GAAP basis, and that'd be the same basis if you pick up a public company's annual report and you look at those financial statements, you're gonna compare apples to apples. But, you know, you talk about increasing value. A lot of times we'll go into a company and we'll see that things are out of whack. Every industry has metrics where they can look at the different ratios and things like that. And oftentimes, companies are just not doing something properly in their operations or in their management or what have you, maybe capitalization even. And so we'll look at those targets and say, what can we do to change our operations or the way we purchase things or how much we store on hand, et cetera, to get us in line with industry standards. And by doing that, that will help you increase your value. But you have to know what the best practices are in order to be able to get to the best practices.
I would just add also that in deference to my colleagues here, and I think they're saying the same thing, small business owners in general, don't like to pay more taxes than they have to. But part of what Dave was talking about is making sure that you document in the appropriate way any of those tax advantages that you take to reduce how much income tax you pay, so that when a third party comes in to evaluate what you did and how you did it, one, you did it according to IRS guidelines, two, it's documented so that a third party can understand it and explain it, and three, it's an appropriate way to minimize your taxes. And I think that's, there's nothing wrong with doing that, you just have to make sure that it's documented properly.
Well, that's another very good point, though. There's two types of sales. There's an asset sale and there's a stock sale or a unit sale. And if you're going to come in and buy the stock of another company, there are a whole new set of tax considerations that you need to think about. A lot of times we'll perform state nexus studies because companies will have nexus in other states, be required to file and not even know it. And the penalties and the additional tax that can come due with that can be huge. And so you want to, like you said, Bill, devil's in the details. You need to keep peeling the layers of that onion back so you're really sure that there aren't a bunch of hidden tax liabilities in there. But absolutely, you want to you want to plan for that, the best taxes. But when you are doing a stock purchase, you need to look at when you bring that company in, what are some of these special tax things that you've done, especially overall method of accounting or accounting for inventory, LIFO, FIFO, lower cost of market? What impact is that going to have on your tax liability when you bring the company in and you conform to your current method of accounting for tax purposes? Sometimes you can get whacked with a huge tax liability, and that's not one of the things you're normally thinking about when you're looking to buy a company. You're looking at those normalized cash flow numbers and EBITDA, things like that. You don't think of those hidden time bombs out there in the form of tax liability or penalties.
Okay, we'll have one more question because we're over as it is. Jack?
Well, just a quick question. You mentioned earlier, and I know this is a small part of it, but I do know of an instance recently where the buyer and the seller were both very interested in maintaining the employee's status. It was really important to them. And then the evaluation of the employment agreements that you recommend in evaluating them, do those, something like a hold harmless agreement, what are you finding in the state of Iowa from a legal standpoint about hold harmless agreements and employment agreements? Are they, when a company is sold, do they usually change, and is the new owner going to have to obtain new employment agreements and or new full farmers agreements?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I knew you were going to do that. Well, that somewhat depends on the structure of the transaction. If you have an asset sale, it will normally not carry over unless you'll have to have those agreements assumed and continued. If it's a stock sale, they will. So I think it's going to be a function principally of the structure of the transaction and how that affects that. But it is something that needs to be looked at in connection with the acquisition, because it's, you know, if you have to put together, for instance, an asset purchase agreement, one of your conditions to closing is likely to be execution of new employment agreements with your key people or confidentiality agreements or whatever it is. And if you don't have that in there, you know, you might be obligated to close without having the key items that make this acquisition attractive to you in place. So.
Kind of a quick side note to that, too. You know, oftentimes people don't realize the importance of the employees and the relationships that they may hold with the customers or with the suppliers and so forth, because oftentimes that's what really derives the value of the company. It's through those employees and those existing relationships that they have out there. And that's, you know, really more personal goodwill, if you will, than goodwill just with the business itself. And so if those employment agreements aren't in place, then a lot of that value might walk out the door upon an acquisition, because if there's nothing holding those folks there, then that value might just skew away.
A related point, too, is that it's always a good idea if you're on the buy side to start developing, you know, what sort of bonus arrangements or incentive compensation you're going to do as you go in, because you need to get, in the process of the acquisition, you need to get a buy-in from these employees. And if you don't do that, then it's, you know, everyone's up in arms and afraid they're going to lose their jobs. Who knows what's going to happen? So that's a very important part of the process as well. So with that, I think we'll wrap up. And thank you, gentlemen, for your discussion. I think we have lunch where we have breakfast, I believe. We'll find it somewhere.